crazy world where people are just giving up too easily. And so I just wanted to basically motivate, uplift, inspire people and basically teach them that they do have skills that pay the bills. And when I talk about that, I talk about everything from, you know, I'm Eastern European. I grew up in an Eastern European household. Came to this country when I was 5 years old. You know, we were pretty poor. And I pretty much, from age 14, just got up and taught myself to go work, go earn everything and everything that I have. And so I kind of start the story at that point of my life. And I go into, you know, how I got into the automotive industry, how I ended up dropping out of college, how I ended up being successful at what I do, but then I also failed twice and went broke, almost lost my home once. And I go into all these things, and basically what I do is I give lessons at the end of every chapter. So you hear my story, and then, or you read my story, and then you get to learn how I overcame this, you know, how I, you know, went from being successful to almost losing everything to paying off $30,000 of debt in 8 months. And, you know, what my steps were to success, you know, and how I came back and where I'm at now, which, you know, next month my business is going to be at a big conference. I'm speaking at this conference. The book is coming out. The social media business, it's a newer business. It's being relaunched. I basically talk about all these different things that essentially everything that you do in your life should generate a skill. You know, and I talk about how it could be anything as simple as driving a manual transmission, right? One day, you know, you learn how to drive a manual transmission car. Next thing you know, 20 years down the road, you're out partying with your friends. And one of your friends drove a car that's a stick shift. And you're the only person that can drive everybody home because you're not drunk and everybody else is. You know, you have that skill, right? So just like that, you should be able to generate a skill off of every little experience that you do in life. And that's essentially what the book is about.
Let's go back when you, because every business, you have the ups and downs of business.
Yes.
And so let's go down to your down. So you have business, and what did it go down? Did it go bankrupt?
So it didn't go bankrupt. I never allowed that to happen. But, you know, myself personally, so the first time it happened in 2013, and a lot of it had to do with people that I associated myself with in the industry. I, you know, right before I started my own training company, 3 years prior to that, I had been running another training company, and the owner of that company and I basically became enemies. I mean, he's just not a very good person. He does a lot of bad for our industry, and anybody that associates with him generally gets bit. And so what happened was we pretty much went head on against each other. This person went, you know, he filed a lawsuit against me, which he got nothing out of. This person also went and defamed my character on social media and cost me a couple $100,000 worth of business opportunities. And I kind of just, you know, hid with my tail between my legs and just went really quiet. Ended up moving to the other part of the state, which essentially is where I was from, and just restarting my life. I rented a studio apartment, lived there for 4 years. For 5 minutes, I got out of the car industry and I got a job, a corporate job as a field territory manager for a marketing company. And it wasn't enough money for me, but it was a good enough job to get me out of the industry. But then I also got sucked back in to go run a used car dealership, an independent dealership, where I took that dealership from selling 8 cars a month to almost 80 cars a month for over $300,000 a month of profit. And I ran that pretty much as like the general manager of the store. I did that for about a year. Simultaneously while working a corporate job. One thing that life has taught me is you can't just rely on one hustle. You have to be out there doing it. And here I was in debt, you know, just I got evicted from my apartment before. So what happened was I needed to get my credit right, get everything right. So in a matter of 2 years, I not only, you know, worked, you know, 2 jobs simultaneously, but I paid off all my debt. I got my life in order. And then 2 years later, I bought my home, which I'm working at my home office right now. And then, of course, you know, I started a social media business and I started to make my comeback. And again, I did work with people that I probably shouldn't have. It's you know, you you get lessons to teach you. And then, you know, I went broke again, but this time it was worse because this time I couldn't pay my mortgage. I had two car payments, and it all stemmed from me working with the wrong clients. What happened was, you know, one person referred me three clients. I worked with three clients that stiffed me for almost $15,000 in 1 month. And that's the kind of money that it takes minimally to make to do what I do for a living. And I got hurt pretty bad. And I had a few months where things went really bad. And then, of course, again, and I talk about this in my book. I went back. I started driving Uber or Lyft. I started applying for jobs. I would apply to 20 jobs a day. I would take job interviews. I would work on rebuilding my connections. And literally within 2 weeks of getting my mind right and doing all these things, opportunities came to me. I went back to work and again, paid off $30,000 of debt in 8 months, got my life together, saved my house, and things are good. You know, eventually a year later, I went back to doing business again, and here we are. And now we're doing really well. We're, like I said, we're doing our first conference that we're actually doing a booth at. I'm speaking at it. So there's a lot of really big growth opportunities coming up in the coming months. But I wouldn't have gotten there if it wasn't for the failures and all the different trials and tribulations of what happened to me.
Yeah, we all, in business, you know, we all have our kind of like ups and downs in business.
Yes.
And when you kind of like at your down, did you feel like you were depressed, you were down, or did you feel like you wanted to give up?
It's depression hits naturally, you know, and it's easy to get depressed. Was I depressed? Of course I got depressed. You know, you spend 3-4 years building a business, you're traveling around the country, you're doing all these things, and all of a sudden you're blacklisted, you're blackballed. People don't want to associate with you because somebody defamed your name. Of course it gets, you know, it becomes depressing, you know, and then you have to, you know, and you sit there for 2-3 months and sulk like I did, because I was trying to figure out what I'm going to do next. And then, you know, all of a sudden you just lift up the courage to just get back, and you're just like, you go back to basics, right? You know, I go back and I think about, what did I do when I was 19 years old? What did I do? I worked three jobs. I went to college. I supported myself. I did, you know, I had that in me where I know that I'm going to make a living and I'm going to do it three times over and at the same time. So I just started getting back to basics. Well, if I did this when I was 19 and, you know, the last time this happened to me, you know, a couple years ago when I went broke, it's like, well, here's what I did 4 years ago. Let me get back, you know, let me get my mind right. You know, of course you have to watch motivational videos, read some books, and more importantly, surround yourself with really good people that lift you up. And once you start to get to that point, the rest is just smooth sailing. You just have to follow a process. You know, I always say, when there's a will, there's a way. And, you know, you get past the depression stage and then you go from there.
So today, are you more active today than you were?
Am I more active today than I was
back then?
Oh yeah, oh yeah. I'm back all over social media. I'm writing articles again for publications. I just pretty much updated my YouTube channel. I'm putting out content every day. I'm doing Zoom calls multiple times a day. Every other week, I'm on the road traveling to another state to do work and work with car dealerships. I am super active. In fact, I have like 5 different things going on at the same time, and there's only so much I can handle. I'm starting to, like, you know, hire people to help me out.
Yeah. So today, what do you actually kind of like into? Because you said you got various businesses. So what is your first priority business?
My number one priority business has and always will be dealer eTraining, because it's in the industry that I've worked in. It's what I know best. It's serving car dealerships. It's training salespeople. That will always be my bread and butter business. That's the business that I failed with twice, and I came back stronger than ever. That's the business that pays the bills for the most part. My other business, I just launched with a partner. I actually had a social media business called Social Share. And the problem is, it was all about me. It was too much about me. So what happened was I closed it down, and I just partnered up with a young lady that does really good social media work, and we just literally last week we formed the corporation. It's called Socially Aware Marketing. And what's interesting about this business is we plan on giving back. So we're going to be donating every single month the proceeds of what we generate for ourselves as a business. We're going to be donating, I don't know if it's 10 or 15%, but it's going to be donated to a different legitimate charity every month. And that's part of our logo. That's part of our slogan. We not only want to help businesses with social media and marketing and getting themselves out there, but we also want them to take part in helping us do something good for a charity.
Brilliant, very good, very good. And with what you do now with the trouble is when you kind of like a car dealership. Now, I remember walking into a car dealership once, and I was the salesman was doing all this patter and everything like that. And sometimes for a car dealership person, it's a lot of pressure on them.
Oh, it certainly is. It certainly is. I mean, anything in life, in my opinion, anything that's commission-based and performance-based is going to have a lot of pressure on them. It's how you handle it. There's people that develop bad habits. They start drinking. They start doing drugs. It's anything. It could be the same way in the stock market. You know, then I have to say, knock on wood or knock on glass in this case, you know, I've never had those issues. I was pretty clean cut. I stayed out of trouble. I just went and did my job. And I think that as I grew too, you know, I mean, I started out when I was 20 years old. I mean, did I go out and party at night with friends after work? Of course I did. But I came to work the next morning. And what's interesting is when I became a manager, and I became a manager at 23 years old, I basically stopped all that. You know, I wanted to come to work on a Saturday morning, you know, fresh, because I'm leading a team, you know. So those things actually, motivated me. You know, the fact, you know, getting in a position of power and responsibility motivated me to stay on the right track. I'm a self-motivated person, and I'm very self-aware of my surroundings and what could happen, you know, if I go this way or that way. So is there a lot of pressure? Of course there is, especially when you're in management. You know, I'm pretty sure by age 24, you know, I was already starting to go bald by age 24. And why? Because there's a lot of stress in it. But, you know, you do what you can, and, you know, you have to deliver a good service to people while you're there. And, you know, you just have to be really good at marketing so you can get more people in front of you to sell to.
So when you're selling your cars then, do you car dealerships, because I ain't got a clue about it, but do they kind of like work on like a percentage, or do they work on like a normal wage?
Okay, so usually they get a percentage of the profit minus whatever the dealer keeps for themselves. So for instance, if you make $3,000 profit on a car, they might pay you 20% up to 30%. Every dealership is different, but out of that 3,000, they might have something called a pack, which is 500, where they only pay you on the 2,500 instead of the 3,000. Also, there's a minimum commission, which back in my day, I've seen it as low as $50 and $75 minimum commission. Most dealerships nowadays pay around $100, $150 per car. That's the minimum. That means that if you sold a car with very little profit, the minimum commission you're going to get paid no matter what is that $100 or $150. It's called a flat or a mini. And I've actually said, I worked at a dealership years ago where I was getting paid $50. And then, of course, sometimes you split a deal. Let's say you're off and your customer comes back. Somebody sells that car for you. You get half of that. So imagine having to work so hard for $25. It's happened. I've stayed till midnight delivering cars for $25. It wasn't fun, but that's just part of the business. But generally speaking, nowadays, the way with the chip shortage and everything, these dealerships are not just giving cars away. Everybody's selling things for a premium. So right now, everybody's making a lot of money selling cars.
Right, okay. So, with your kind of like doing your dealerships and everything, so do you kind of like, do you go around kind of like uh, keep an eye on staff and what they're doing, and you know what pressures they, you know what the sales and everything.
That is correct. So the first things that I look for is the culture. Everything comes down to the culture of the dealership, from the owner down, general manager down, to how the people in the dealership are acting. That's number one. Culture can either, you know, a positive culture can get a store that's just rocking out. You know, you put some good music on, you put some good vibes on, everybody knows what their job is. They're trained every single day, and everybody just, you know, they take their customers, they sell cars, and they're selling a lot of cars. I'm talking about high volume dealerships that sell 300 to 1,000 cars a month. Then there's dealerships that have really poor culture, that nobody cares about the employees, nobody cares about the dealership. You know, they're very frugal on how they invest in their advertising, and it's just a, you know, you feel like you're in a funeral parlor, right? People come there to die. So it's funny how that works out. But, you know, I would say number one is the culture of the dealership. But number two, it's the advertising. How much do you advertise? You know, how aggressive are you? How many opportunities come through the door? Then, of course, there's the department that I focus on is the Business Development Center, or the Internet Sales Department, that handles all the internet inquiries that come in, handles all the incoming phone calls. How well are they talking to customers, and how well are they bringing the customers in the door? And then from there, it goes to the salespeople. Are they, you know, how well do they take over the process when the customer is in the dealership? So I focus on those key areas. I don't really focus on anything past that. Like, I don't focus on the F&I or finance department. I do focus on the retention strategies. So really for me, it's working with the marketing department, which, you know, I consider the Business Development Center the billboard of yesterday. So in the past, you drive by, you'd see this big billboard, and it would say, you know, Jones Motors, you know, over 900 new Chevys in stock, you know, come down, you know, come visit us, and it'd have an arrow. In my opinion, that's so old school. Nowadays, you have a department that talks to people, to bring people in. People are not just walking into dealerships. People are shopping online. They have all the tools. And so it's important to have skills to be able to actually speak to people.
Yeah. And that's correct, because we've got technology now. You know, we can buy a car online instead of even going to the showroom. So, you know, how do you cope with that if many people start coming into the showroom?
What do you mean?
How do you cope with it? Because some people could buy a car online, and they could do it at home, can't they? And buy a car, and other people go into the showroom.
Okay, so, well, what happened was, many years ago, a lot of digital marketing companies started a tool called digital retailing. And it's been a buzzword in our industry for a couple of years now. And especially when COVID hit last year, what happened was a lot of dealerships laid people off. And some only had a select few people working. And so these digital retailing tools were there, where a customer, and most, if you look in the United States, most new car dealerships on their website have some form of digital retailing tool, which allows a customer to start the transaction. They see their price, they see their financing, they can essentially upload their insurance card, their driver's license, and they can follow the process. I can tell you from my experience, dealerships, maybe one or two a month actually fully do a transaction this way. I still feel like it's a people's business. You know, I always tell people, I'm not in the car business, I'm in the communication business. Because I teach people how to communicate better. As far as completing a deal online, people still want to deal with people. You know, you have your Carvanas and your Vrooms and all your digital disruptors. And it's so funny that we bring that up, right? Because just about, and I'm looking at my phone, because literally just about 10 minutes before I got on this, I was watching a video on LinkedIn where somebody on the news was complaining about Carvana, you know, and they were talking about how people in Florida are buying cars on Carvana and they're not getting their plates and they're not getting their titles for months at a time. And then when you go to call Carvana, nobody ever responds. Nobody cares to follow up with the customer. So how, you know, so as much as people are saying, oh, you know, I want to go and do my one price shopping, I'm going to just go to Carvana and buy a car, it's a much better experience. Well, no, it isn't, because when you need to put a plate on your car, you know, you can't get in touch with Carvana. They just ignore you. When you have a problem with your title, you know, they don't care. You know, yeah, you bought a car off a vending machine, or you bought a car that got delivered to you. That's all they know. So reality of it is, this is still a people business. You know, it kills me that they're trying to go out there and hurt our car dealership business model, because, you know, people in the dealership, you know, you have an accounting department, you have a title department, you actually have somebody you can get a hold of that can actually help take care of your problem. Most dealerships out there are not going to sell a car without having a title ready to go. And for some odd reason, Carvana is doing that. And they're starting to get hurt in the media. They're starting to get hurt in some markets where they're banned from selling cars for a year. And so, you know, you do have all these digital retailing tools, which in my opinion, for a car dealership, all that does is it generates a lead or an opportunity. And we have to be able to teach our people, and this is something that I've been really focused on in the last years, we have to teach our people to use these tools to be able to have an intelligent conversation with a customer. You know, if I'm working a deal, let's say you're in the dealership with me and you're negotiating with me, I don't need to go back and forth to my sales manager 20 times. I can pull up a digital retailing tool, see where I'm at, and then go back and say, okay, this is the deal that I have. Are we going to take it or are we not going to take it? You know, so I don't necessarily think that the model of just buying online is going to 100% take over. You know, they always used to say when I was learning this business, the feel of the wheel makes the deal. And that's true. You know, I want to drive a car before I buy it. I'm not buying a five-year-old used car from, I live in New Jersey, right, from Texas and having it shipped here. What if I don't like the car? Why do I want to deal with the hassle? I'm just going to go drive a car locally. Or if I'm going to buy a car in Texas, I'm going to fly to Texas. I'm going to drive that car. I'll do the experience. I'll drive the car back and at least enjoy the views of driving around, you know, doing a cross-country tour. You know, but I won't buy. It's the second biggest purchase of my life. I'm not going to buy my house without seeing it. Why would I buy my car without driving it? What if the seats aren't comfortable? What if the Apple CarPlay doesn't work? What if I don't like the screen? You know, what if the visibility is wrong? What if the car's too slow for me? All these things are important. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
Yeah, what I want to know, you've got a question, yeah?
Sure.
And he said, hi, Steve, can you ask Dan, what is the most expensive car he's ever sold?
The most expensive car I've ever sold? It was probably a BMW. I would say a BMW M5. When I was coming up in the industry, I moved around a couple dealerships. So, you know, I worked for my first dealership for 2 years. Then I went and moved to another state, worked there for a year. And then when I came back to New Jersey, I moved around in my first year. You know, I worked at an Infiniti dealership. I worked at a BMW dealership. I would say the most expensive car I sold was an M5. And it was somewhere over $100,000. I mean, this was going back 2006. So I really wouldn't remember how much it went for, but that was probably the most expensive car I sold.
Gosh. And how much did you get for that then?
My commission was probably $1,500.
It's not much, is it?
What's that?
It's not much, is it?
It really wasn't. I'm sure if it was today, it'd probably be $3,000 or $4,000 because we'd be selling it at a premium with the chip shortage. But you know, the goal is to sell. My goal was always to sell 3-4 cars a week. You know, and half of them would be minimum commissions. The other half would be, you know, profitable deals. I mean, you know, when I was a salesperson, I sold Acuras for a while. For a year, I was actually, you know, one of the top paid Acura salespeople in New Jersey. I remember my competitor was another dealer, and we were both young. We were both around, you know, 22, 23 years old, and we were just killing it, you know. I remember his name was Alex. He was working at Springfield Acura. I mean, this guy was, he was selling double the cars I was, but at the same, we were making about the same money. I would meet him at Acura meetings, and I'm like, wow, this guy's really killing it. I was working at a smaller store, and I was having $3,000-$4,000 weeks, You know, I would sell 4 or 5 cars and I would make that money. Especially selling certified pre-owned Acuras at the time that came right out of the service drive. You know, it's a very lucrative business. If you, once you learn how to do things and once you become process oriented and, you know, you start to love what you do. Like I loved what I did and that pushed me. You know, when you're 23 years old and you're getting paid on Friday and you show up to the bank and, you know, we didn't have direct deposit at the time. Show up to the bank and you're going to cash your check and, you know, you got a $3,000-$4,000 check and, you know, it kind of boosts your ego a little bit, but it's like you got a very attractive female who's your bank teller and she sees you're young and you're cashing these kind of checks. It's like, wow, it's like, what do? You know, you get really motivated by success. And, you know, to me, that was success. And then, of course, I moved on from there, but it was certainly fun to do. I mean, I had friends that were my age that were not doing it. They were just finishing up college and they were starting out in their respective careers. I had one of my best friends was still living at home at the time. You know, finally he started a career and now he's a multimillionaire, you know, fast forward, you know, 15 years later. But, you know, it was fun. It definitely motivated me. It definitely showed me that, you know, no matter what happens in life, I have something to fall back in. And like right now, if things got bad for me, right? If I was on the verge of losing things, what am I going to do? I'll go work at a car dealership. You know, my worst case scenario in life is better than most people's best case scenario. And I've lived by that motto because I know that worst comes to worst, I'll get a job at a car dealership. I know that I can hustle. I know I can make a good living. And, you know, do I want to work in retail? Of course not, because I've done it. You know, I don't want to deal with the pressure of it. But I know that if you drop me off at any part of the country and say, here, go figure it out, I know that I'll make something happen.
Thank you so much, Dan. Thank you very much for coming on.
Oh, my pleasure.
I'll be able to get you back again because I'm going to go through your book.
Yeah, I'm going to send you the book. You know, right now it's being edited. I'm literally hiring a designer and a formatter today. Today's the 22nd. I'm trying to have this book out by October 10th. So I need to get on it because... I'll be at the Digital Dealer Conference in Las Vegas, October 12th to the 14th, where I have a booth and I'm also speaking there. And I plan on bringing a few hundred copies and sharing it with my industry colleagues. And so I definitely, will send you a copy of the book signed and would love, you know, your feedback on it and we can discuss it more. There's going to be a lot of promotions on the book. I plan on going pretty heavy with that book for the next 6 months.
Yeah. And... We would love to have you back. What we'll do is get you back in again and kind of like talk to you more.
Sure.
About
that. So I appreciate that.
Okay, so we will get on top of that. And so that's really good. That's really good. Okay, folks, we're going to be back again later on. In the meantime, thank you to Stan.
Thank you.
And that was really interesting, Sam. Honestly, that was really good.
I appreciate that. It's fun to be on here. Thank you.
Brilliant. And if you want to contact